Welcome, everybody, to this week's The Top 10 Show. As always, I'm one of your hosts here, John Rocha, joined by my one of the funniest men on the planet. And as I've said this numerous times, a sneaker aficionado. We got to think of other things. What else are you into?
All kinds of things. I don't know why you've fixated upon that, because I don't think we've ever had a discussion on air about shoes at all.
Yeah.
And
I just know that you talk about it all the time off air.
Really?
Yeah, we've talked about it a number of times.
Like all the time? All the time means if you want to say basketball, I talk basketball pretty much all the time.
What's connected? What are they wearing when they play basketball?
Yeah, but I rarely have ever talked sneakers. It's not like we haven't. When have we had a sneaker discussion?
Many, many times.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
You want to have a debate about it now?
Apparently I black out during our conversations. And I have no recollection. Maybe I'm drinking again. I don't know.
No, don't say
Maybe
that.
Maybe it is. I don't know.
No, I need you to come to the show.
I'm time traveling through again. My life. I don't know what's happening.
You're going to Stranger Things. You're going into the Upside Down. That's what's happening. God. Anyway, tell them who you are.
I'm Matt Nost. Hey, thanks for tuning in. That's great. That was nice. It was gentle the way you set that up.
Totally.
Happy to be here. It's nice to be here with you.
You too, my friend.
We are doing the top 10 epics in honor of Ben-Hur coming out, the remake this weekend.
Yeah, the remake coming out with Toby Kebbell. Yeah, and Houston. Yes, Jack Houston in there too as well. People know from Boardwalk Empire as Richard. Yeah, great stuff. I'm not 100% looking forward to this remake because I love the remake. Which is what the Charlton Heston Ben-Hur is a remake of the 1929 version of silent version of
Ben-Hur.
Did
they both make your list?
No.
You sure?
Both did not make my list. But certainly one did. So that's fine.
You can have it on your list. You enjoy it on your list?
I love it on my list.
That's perfectly
fine. It's such a great film, and so we're going to get to it, but I want to see what this remake is like.
I have zero belief.
I would like it to be good, but I don't know.
I have zero belief this is going to be good. Yeah. None whatsoever.
And throwing in Morgan Freeman has shades of that Robin Hood Prince of Thieves movie.
Is his part going to be that big? You know what I mean?
Maybe.
Or is it going to be more like, what is that, Tom Cruise Oblivion? Or it's not Oblivion, but Morgan Freeman is prominently displayed.
Yeah, Oblivion, yeah.
And in the movie, it's just like, that dude was, I think, shot 3 days on the film.
Yeah, tops.
And he's on tons of the advertising, so.
Anyway, well, look, thanks, guys, for joining us this week, and we are looking forward to counting this down. Matt, you want to tell them how the show works?
Sure. Once John and I set a topic, we go our separate ways, and we create our personal top 10 list. Then we show back up here, and I do my bottom three. He does his bottom three. I do my next two. He does his next two. Then we trade one apiece. Once we revealed our personal top 10 lists, we create the shows between the two of us.
Boom. And please explain punt for our non-American friends.
I appreciate the setup to give me second there. To recalibrate. Punting is just this. It's an American football term. We're just kicking the discussion further down the list for whoever has it higher. So if he's got something at 6 and I got it at 10, then we're going to share the love at 6 on his list as opposed to wasting it at 10 on mine. That's all that means. So we're just moving the discussion.
Yeah. You got it now? Are we good? For God's sakes, we have to explain it every week. Come on.
You're picking a fight with ghosts. Good luck to you. You're going to lose every time.
This is my life.
Yeah.
Anyway, so let's get to it. Matt, you want to start us off?
Yes. At number 10 is an absolute classic, which is Spartacus.
We're punting.
Okay, we're punting.
All right.
Right off the bat. Let's see that gorgeous
graphic.
Put it on the... There we go.
Matt won't... No. Yes. Adam, there it is.
Gorgeous.
Boom, Adam. Love it. Why is the football black and white? I've never understood that.
Who knows?
Anyway, all right.
Who knows?
What's your number 9?
Maybe you just got to adjust the tent or something.
Yeah, the tent? Is that what it is?
At number 9
What is it, VHF? Well, yeah.
Okay.
A UHF, whatever that is.
Is Last of the Mohicans.
Oh, I didn't put that on my list. I don't consider that an epic, so this is great. Please take it.
That's the problem, I guess, on some level with epic.
Yeah.
Because now the definition can kind of apply to so much stuff.
Well, that's why this show is great for that, because it's like your version of what an epic is and my version of what an epic is. It's going to be fun to talk about
over the original version of it, in the golden age of Hollywood, it has to be like a historical piece with a singular hero.
3 hours long.
Exactly. Huge set pieces and lavish costumes. And now it's kind of been more like it needs to be a hero's arc.
Yeah.
But, in great set design and all that stuff, it needs to feel epic and it needs to tell. Kind of a complete story if it can.
Yeah.
Even if that story takes three and a half, 4 hours, whatever it takes. But Last of the Mohicans is, I think, when I realized Daniel Day-Lewis was amazing.
Oh, okay.
As a kid. Because I had seen some of those, but I didn't see my left foot. My left foot. Thank you. I was about to say red shoe.
The man with one red shoe.
Yeah, exactly. I'm getting them all confused in my head. It's not a good thing.
He had a small part in
I didn't see my left foot until I was older.
Yeah.
So I think this might have been my introduction. Maybe he had parts in other things, but this is the first time I remember him.
He was in Gandhi. He had a real smart part
Still
in
haven't
Gandhi.
Seen it.
Oh,
Could
my
be on your
gosh.
List. Could be on your list.
Maybe.
Yeah, still haven't seen it. You've talked about it now for a little over a year to me.
I
agree it's probably good.
I keep offering you the Blu-ray.
But it keeps slipping through the cracks because other movies keep coming out.
That's true.
And sometimes you just can't catch up to everything. I'd like to. It'd be great.
I'm sure you would.
But in this, it's a great tale of... So there's the old English Empire is still trying to impose its will upon the colonies. You have the colonists fighting back against that. It's the start of the Revolutionary War. And then you have these... various factions of Native Americans mixed in that are on the French side or on the English side or on the the colonialist side. And it's just a story in between where one family gets sucked in along with Day Lewis and two other Native Americans. They're Mohicans. They're the last of the Mohicans.
Hey-o.
And they go and it's a rescue mission at the end of the day. And it's just so beautiful, and you really feel like the emotional moments that they build up to between him and the girl,
the
fact that he has to, you can feel the primal need in him to get her back.
Stay alive. I will find you. Stay alive.
Don't you believe that? If another actor said that, you're like, BS, man. I don't. That is terrible dialogue.
Yeah.
And Day Lewis doing it and be like, you need to stay alive now.
I'm like, please don't die.
Back.
Yeah. Please don't die.
He's coming back. Trust me. Yeah. This is Day Lewis.
Yeah, and it's great stuff. You know, Russell Means, Wes Studi, all great stuff, doing these really powerful Native American. Russell Means was actually part of the Native American movement protest in the 70s, part of AIM. He was part of that, the American Indian movement. So it's all of this was factored into this. And obviously, it takes the novel what James Fenimore Cooper wrote and really fleshes it out and creates a whole nother story. You got the love story, which is really great with Madeleine Stowe, really believable. But then you have the British guard who was in love with Madeleine Stowe, but then sacrifices himself. It's Colin Firth's brother in real life. Yep. It's really cool.
But
man.
Doesn't like at first he's not. He's playing the stereotypical
he's a jerk.
Dick.
Yeah.
And just when he
those Brits.
Yeah, makes the turn, and then Day Lewis doing the compassionate thing of taking him out.
Yeah,
like that's a harrowing choice. We have to put him out of his misery because right now he would choose anything but what he's going through.
Yeah.
And I understand that as compassion. We may not have gotten along, but right now I would hope you would do that for me.
Right. Plus a great score, I think, by James Newton Howard. So.
And just beautiful cinematography.
Absolutely.
The great shots of them just running through the forest. Mm-hmm. Whoever thought that running through like Appalachia could look so amazing.
Especially in slow motion.
Yeah, it's great.
All right, what's your number eight?
My number eight.
It's the greatest.
It is. My number eight is Gladiator with Russell Crowe.
That's my number eight.
Is it really?
Nailed it. Yes.
Perfect placement on that.
Let's talk about it. Ridley Scott.
Yeah. An excellent epic. It's kind of... It seems like one of those in the same way, like nobody did pirate movies for the longest time.
Yeah.
You don't go back and do Roman epics because they're just so hard.
The sandal epics are tough.
Yeah, they're so hard to do. And this one came out of nowhere with an actor that most people did not know. And
yeah, I guess you're right. By that time,
on that
he
level,
was getting known, but he wasn't. Yeah, yeah, he wasn't a star.
This presented
yet.
Him to the world. You may have remembered him in like what was it, Virtuosity?
Yeah, sure.
Or like other, there's that one from Rumble, whatever the Australian. Which the Australian one where he plays like a neo-Nazi or it's like almost American History X. Like you might have heard about these underground
Romper Stomper.
I was about to say Rumblefish, and I was like, that's way off.
Rumble Bumble,
Swimmy.
Yeah, totally.
Samsonite. that's the way my brain works.
Oh yeah,
but the opening of this, and they're just set up against the Germanic hordes.
So great!
It's a great opening, and at no point do you not believe that Russell Crowe is this character.
Yeah,
it's just kind of impossible to do. How do you pull off a Roman general who also then understands the importance of having a king, a Caesar?
Yeah,
that they can do things that someone like a Roman general couldn't, even though they would have the force and the power behind them that they wanted to lead.
Yeah.
Leading it's that plus having the intellect and the foresight and it's all and compassion and there's so many things built into it and knowing that he needs to be subservient to Marcus Aurelius in order for the betterment of the full Roman Empire. And then Phoenix just comes storming in like a petulant child and just flips the table. He's not getting what he wants, so he takes it.
Yeah.
And then just the clash the two of them have as it builds the crescendo at the end. It's so excellent.
Yeah, he's such a great villain, Joaquin. And then Connie Nielsen is great as his sister, playing a love interest for Russell Crowe. And you have Russell with his wife. So it's a revenge film, right? It's a revenge film shoehorned into this epic, right?
It's a two-part revenge film.
Right, exactly, because he has to go...
For his family and for Marcus Aurelius.
And then for Marcus Aurelius, for Richard Harris, right, who's on, which is so great when you read the history of this the actual history of this. None of this is true.
It's called dramatic license.
Yes, Joaquin Phoenix was actually a great emperor. He was not a bad person. Brought the aqueducts, like really saved the society.
And I don't know if Marcus Aurelius was as beloved as he's made out to be in this film.
This was so interesting. But
we're here to tell a story.
That's right.
So
that's right.
I think they'd be happy they're in a movie 2,000 years later. Like people know what's a movie. And then we have to explain to them movies and all that stuff. But still. He'd be blown away.
That's a long podcast with that person. All right. What's your number 7? Oh, no, wait. Do we go to me now? I'm so used to FOMO.
Yeah, that was. Yeah.
All right. So then my number 10, which I wonder if it'll be higher on your list, is The Bridge on the River Kwai.
It is not on my list.
Wow. Really?
But you just wondered if it was going to be higher and then are blown away when it's not.
I thought you would like it. I thought you'd like World War II, this film. So because you're such a student of history, I thought you'd like this film or have it revered as an
epic.
It just,
when it comes to epics, when I started thinking about making this list, there's so many excellent choices that I love.
There really are. You're right.
It's a matter of, like, this is really a subjective one.
Yeah.
Because there's 15 that didn't make the cut.
Right.
I can make a case for every one
absolutely.
Of them.
Absolutely. Same thing, yeah. 1957, directed by David Lean, mm-hmm. who's basically the godfather of epics here in America. Just fantastic stuff. Alec Guinness, William Holden, Jack Hawkins. The film won 7 Oscars. Best Picture, Best Actor, Director, Cinematography, amongst others. Really great film that explores this idea of civility versus war. You know, the idea, how do you act? The idea of nobility. Gentlemen, it's the first breaking down of this idea that you actually can be tricked. The enemy can play you against your morals and your feelings of what you should do as the right person, because to them, they are more cutthroat and more desirous of a victory by any means than you are by the proper means. And when Alec Guinness figures out what's happening, the look on his face is so amazing, and the weight of the disappointment of the soldiers that he has let down for what he's done, being tricked into this situation, is just so brilliant.
But it's at the end of the day, it's predicated on the idea that we need to go over there and kill more of those people.
Yes.
So it doesn't matter if you got duped. You had dubious intentions on the outset. Whenever, even
that's
if you come
point.
From a moralistic high ground, one man's angel is another man's devil. So just because you believe you're doing the right thing, from their perspective, you're, you know, hell on a horse.
Exactly.
I don't want to see you.
Exactly.
So the fact that, they do a movie like this where it exposes me. Like, look, there's undercutting. There's deals made all the time. There's motivations are corrupted for someone else's ultimate goal. So did you get played? Well, it sucks for you.
Yeah.
But the war continues on.
Yeah, and I love that scene of him falling on the detonator. Mm-hmm. Just brilliant, brilliant stuff. It's so much fun to watch and explore and enjoy so much. All right, my number 9 is The Last Emperor. Is that on your list?
It was one of my tough omissions.
Okay.
Yeah.
I absolutely love this movie. I've seen this movie so many, so many times. I've seen it in theaters. I've seen it on VHS, DVD, Blu-ray. I think it's one of the most fantastic films ever made in terms of exploring a culture through the decades and the changes in the political climate that occur in this culture. Bernardo Bertolucci did the film. I don't think he's ever done a better film than this film. I think this is the height of what he did as a director.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's going to fight you on that.
Yeah.
Nothing against him. I agree.
And it's so fantastic because you have John Lone there, who I absolutely love. John Lone is one of my favorite actors, period, Asian or otherwise. I loved him in Iceman, that Timothy Hutton film. Timothy Bottoms.
Oh, wow.
I loved him in
Him in it, or did you love the movie as well?
No, I love the movie as well. I loved him in Year of the Dragon, that quiet little film with Mickey Rourke, where he plays the head of the Yakuza.
Yeah.
That's so fantastic. John Lone did such great, and of course he's in Rush Hour as the villain, but he did such great work through the 80s, and this is really the pinnacle of him as an actor, watching him play this character from a young man to an older man, ending up under the footsteps of Mao and the communist political movement at the time. So you see him at the emperor, and you see the excesses, and you see him learning the lessons of betrayal, of love gone wrong, of this idea of people should be bowing down to him, and him having to accept the humility of it.
Yeah,
it's so fantastic.
He comes to the realization that he's just a regular person like everybody else.
Yes.
Like every king and emperor before them.
Yeah.
You know, death comes to you just like it does the rest of us.
Right.
You're just a person. You don't have some divinity through God.
Yeah.
You're just a guy. Welcome to the real world.
Exactly. And I think it's a fantastical thing to it's a fantastical realm to explore it in, because you as a human being have your moments where you feel like you're a king of the world when you're 20s or 30s. I can't be stopped. And next thing you know, you're 50 or 60 and you're hobbling to the
bathroom. Yeah, you realize, I can't be stopped.
Yeah, I can be stopped a number of times.
Life is really good at that, actually. Really good. Just when you think you've figured out the equation, it's just like, you didn't think about this. Achilles gone. You're like, okay, I'm hobbling this way forever now.
That's right. And you have to adapt to the situation. So, all right, we already did my number 8, which is your number 8. So what's your number 7?
My number 7, This is part of the loose interpretation.
Okay.
Master and Commander, The Far Side of the World.
All right. You love that film.
Love
so
that film.
Go ahead.
I love that
two
film.
Two Russells back to back.
I know. I that's it. Why
all
I did it.
Go ahead.
That's why specifically why I did it. Looking at it, I was hoping it would land where I could do like 6-7 or something, but just like going Russell. The guy's good at it.
He really is.
And if you've never seen Master and Commander, please treat yourself. It's phenomenal. I wish they had set it up to be a series because it's based on some books.
Yeah.
And I loved the first one. It didn't do anything at the box office, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I thought it was just genius.
It's a fantastic film.
It is. It's. I've read so many books over the years of going out, you know, with Ferdinand Magellan or anybody like that that spent years on a boat.
Yeah.
And this weird ecosystem of here's life and death. Here's actually what's right and wrong. Here are all these things. Like when the one sailor gives the shoulder bump to the officer, and they have to give him lashings, because if they don't give him lashings, then we have mutiny and chaos, and our little world crumbles.
Yep.
We have to maintain this little order at all times, and when they cut a rope on a guy and set him adrift, because they have no other choice, but you feel it in the moment, all these characters' pain of having to basically be a person and deal with everything that's going around them. They're going around the Cape of Good Hope.
Yeah.
Around the tip of Africa, just some of the worst weather in the world, but you have to get around that, and then you can make it around the other side. It gets better after that. And it doesn't go well.
Yeah.
And their world kind of goes upside down, and you have to make a choice in the midst of all this. And that's just one part of this amazing, movie. And my favorite aspect of it is I've read accounts where all these things do happen because they're gone for a year and a half, 2 years, sometimes 3 years, which is like, there's enough stories that build up. They hit, you know. You're going to have a lot of bad days.
Yeah.
And within this movie, and then the cunning at the end when they do what they do. I don't want to ruin it if you haven't seen it.
Yeah.
I love this film.
Yeah, absolutely. And the relationship between him and Paul Bettany is just fantastic.
Brilliant.
Just great. Great camaraderie between the two. And you actually believe it. Like, it transcends what you're watching on film. It's almost viscerally so real to you that it helps you buy into the movie even more.
Them playing the music is the only part.
Oh, well, sure. But
of the movie where it's just like, do we have to go to this again?
Slide because all the ones are so great.
Yeah, everything else is so good. And it does. It helps cement early on their friendship. It lays the seed of it, and you build thereafter. Yeah. And then once like the Darwinian aspects, and he's teaching him, and he uses that, and they learn from one another, and you can see the sense of respect they have.
Yeah. Plus some great seafaring battles, which are fantastic to watch when they're done well, and they're really done well in this movie. All right. What's your number six?
My number six is The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King.
Okay.
Didn't make it?
No.
Why is that?
I'm not a fan of these films. I understand
that was like
people,
Junior walking. That was great.
I understand that people like these films. I get it. They're beautiful. They're majestic. Peter Jackson won an Oscar. Totally get it. But the six endings are laborious, man.
See, for me in the theater watching it, I was like, we could have tacked on two more endings.
Yeah,
I was fine with
really?
It.
You'd have been fine with it?
In between the releases, a friend of mine kept buying the extended cuts.
Oh, yeah. Those were extra 45 minutes.
Exactly. And I couldn't get enough because the amount of care that he put into building the world.
Oh, no. It's amazing. I'm not saying anything like that.
It's flabbergasting that they managed to churn out that many hours in that short amount of time.
Right.
I mean, it still took years.
Yeah.
But to put out that much, it looks like it took 20 years.
Oh, yeah. Respect and attention must be paid to the work that Weta does at the workshop which is what, and this Weta was announced through these films
through
and the work they could do. Yeah. Almost like ILM in a way.
So it was Peter Jackson.
Right. Peter Jackson.
Yeah. Nobody knew he had this gear.
Right.
Just like they didn't know about Weta and just about, you know, anyone else that was involved that was unknown to, you know, Hollywood because they had to cut costs somewhere. Be like, hey, Weta doesn't cost us anything. I know they can do great work.
And Sean Astin will work for scale. Yeah.
And the blacksmith on set, I'm sure he was a local New Zealander.
That's right. Yeah,
I believe I saw like a behind the scenes, and he was, and they found him, and he just happens to do this amazing work. And you're like, perfect, let's get him on board. I guess you have that free time when you're shepherding all day.
I can't explain why I don't feel more of a connection to these films. And
you're
dead
on the inside. There's your explanation.
Shut up. I feel more of a connection to the Hobbit films than I do these. So this is really
to
weird.
The newest that came out, or the cartoon?
No, the newest ones that came out, the new three films.
Really?
Yeah, I do. I can't explain it. There is no explanation.
It doesn't make sense.
I think the dwarfs thing really appeals to me more than this whole, like, I'm the Knight Rider or whatever Viggo Mortensen's name is in the film. And
Knight Rider?
Whatever his name is. And
he's got that red thing going across his, his brow the whole time.
I mean, but there's a name for him or something. There's a name for him in the film. I can't remember what it is. You know, Liv Tyler or Miranda. Miranda Otto's fantastic in the film. Liv Tyler. And so there's just stuff that goes on for me.
Hugo
that
takes
Weaving
away. Is excellent
Hugo
in the
Weaving
film.
Is great. So is Cate Blanchett.
Ian McKellen is excellent in the film.
Yes. But you get all of that in the Hobbit stuff, too. You get Cate Blanchett. You get Hugo
but you
Weaving.
Get, like, you get junior versions of them.
Not in my opinion. And Lee Pace is great as the elf king, the evil elf king.
Look, I love Lee Pace.
We argued that this 4 hours.
Just don't. I don't care for that. That character to me doesn't. I don't get it overall.
Well, I don't get the dude on the kingdom who's having Pippin sing songs for him while his son is burning to. Like, that's the stupidest thing
because
in those trilogies.
He's mad and drunk with power.
Yeah, mad and drunk with power.
He's mad and drunk with power.
That's what it is.
He doesn't care for his one son. Yeah. His other son, you know, dies, but he's supposed to be a steward. He's holding on to power, but knows that that power is fleeting.
I should do my own commentary on these films.
Go right ahead. If you want negative people to tune in,
negative
people are somehow going to tune into that.
YouTube.
Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King is excellent.
Anyway, yeah, there we go. All right.
Normally I say attack me, but attack him this
attack
week.
Attack me, that's right.
This man is un-American.
It's not about America.
Un-American.
It's not even said in America.
It was released
about?
By an American production company,
what?
Which makes it American.
Sure, New Line. All right, that was your number six?
That was my number six.
My number seven is Spartacus, which we punted from, I think, from earlier.
Perfect, yes.
Yes, 1960, Stanley Kubrick, Kirk Douglas, Tony Curtis, Peter Ustinov. Tony Curtis, I'm Spartacus. Charles Laughton, Laurence Olivier, Gene Simmons, written by Dalton Trumbo, who was blacklisted. That's my Tony Curtis. Best
I know, we got to have Roka's impression corner. You do that, you do the best Trump I've ever seen.
Come on.
You do a few others.
I do Bernie
dynamite.
Really well. I can do Bernie really well. Trumbo, great, and it won 4 Oscars, the film. Trumbo couldn't accept it because he was blacklisted.
Yeah, he was blacklisted.
Yeah, but it's such a fantastic. I saw this film with Kirk Douglas at the TCM Film Festival 2 or 3 years ago. 92, 91 years ago, came out, talked about. I was a child. I became 5 years old just watching this man talk about the production history of the film and how it came about. I really love this film. There's so much power in the character of Spartacus.
Oh, yeah.
So much about, like, the scope of the film is amazing. And you still have the quirky little stuff with Ustinov, with Charles Laughton. Charles Laughton, who's at the top of his game, doing the smarmy, heavy guy, who knows how to play the game politically. And that's what's so great about the film. It's very reminiscent of Braveheart in a way, you know, because he's a slave who just kind of figures things out and grabs a movement.
Yeah,
and,
you know, and someone that's subjugated and they rise up through the ranks and they become basically just a monolithic force. You can't stop them at any cost. Yeah.
And great stuff. And you know, the scene at the end where he's crucified and what, I mean, come on, it's a 60 year spoiler alert. So, but he's crucified, but Gene Simmons comes
technically in. It's a couple thousand year old spoiler alert. So if you don't know about it, break out to the rise and fall of the Roman Empire and open to chapter like 5 or actually volume 5
volume
of
five.
The compendium that
chapter
it is.
Chapter 247.
It's in there somewhere.
Anyway, it's just such a really powerful film. And I think Kirk Douglas is never better as an actor than he is in this film.
I mean, it just raw power.
Yeah.
Like those early guys, a lot of times, like on some level to me, because I visited them after their apex, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So you don't experience them in the same way.
Right.
Like for my dad's generation, like Steve McQueen was it.
Yeah,
and
sure.
To me, it's like, I get it, but I didn't live through it, so he doesn't capture that part of my imagination. Yeah. Whereas I still like the guy. Whereas Douglas, I get it.
Yeah.
Like he still has that power 50 some odd years later.
Yeah.
When you watch it, you're like, this guy just comes in swinging, like, just from charisma and swagger and everything else. The amount of confidence that he has within the character and himself just comes rolling through the screen.
Him and Burt Lancaster were the two guys in the 50s who really revolutionized working out for the actor, like working out muscle, weightlifting, all this kind of. They were really adamant about this kind of stuff. They brought training into their work as an actor. And Kirk Douglas always radiates this feeling he could walk through a granite wall, just walk through
his
it.
Chin
like,
alone could do
chin,
it.
That's what I'm saying. Just walking forward, he would just walk through a granite wall. He's so
you
amazing.
That BattleBots Jay Leno that's got the chin up against him and just have him battle it out. See who wins. I think they're bringing that show back for a 10th time.
By the way, for you kids, Frank Gorshin does an amazing Kirk Douglas imitation. The way he played the Riddler in the old Batman series. All right. My number six is There Will Be Blood. 2007. Paul Thomas Anderson. Is that on your list?
I don't. You know what? I don't think of that as an epic, I guess.
But Last of the Mohicans is an epic?
Well, I guess I start with from the point of a hero's journey.
Okay.
So that, to me, is
that's fair.
What is compelling about an epic is no matter where he starts, it's a hero's. Even if he fails, it's a hero's journey, whereas this is an anti-hero story.
This is what, but it spans
It's an epic
decades.
Story.
Yeah.
I'm not going to fight you.
No, it should be
on the list.
Yeah.
I love the movie.
I think it's such a great film, and we've been dying to talk about this film, but I thought it was the perfect place to put this film at for me as an epic. I think it spans decades, but I think it's Daniel Day-Lewis, once again, as with Kirk Douglas, I think at the top of his game as an actor. I know Lincoln, he's fantastic, and Lincoln, he really embodies Lincoln, but for me, the level that he's playing with here, the Will Be Blood, is just like almost as deep as the oil they're searching for. It's that deep what he's working with as a character.
I think what speaks volumes about it is if you put most other actors into that, and I would say 99.9, I want that movie cut down by 30 to 40 minutes.
That's a great point.
Yeah. So, whereas with him, I want to see him at the diner talking trash behind the napkin that he holds up. Yeah. I want to see him exchanges. I guess you would still need the brother.
Yeah.
But like the other aspects that you could cut out within the film, like I want to see how this character grows and develops and becomes the bitter, exiled individual that's on his own island by his own doing.
Yes.
I want to see every bridge that he burns that ends him up there. Like the first time I saw it, I was sitting next to four people who are older than the character in the movie.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, and when it ends, the lady who was sitting right next to me just turns to her friend and was like, "Is that it?" And in my head, I went, "Yes! Yes, he's a bitter alcoholic.
That is it.
It destroyed everything around him. Where else should it end?
Right.
This is the perfect place. Like, I know a few of these guys like this. And if they continue down this path, they're going to end up just like him."
Well, it's so fascinating because at the beginning, you kind of cheer for him because he's trying to create a business. He's trying to survive. You know he doesn't have a lot of money. He crawls out of that pit, you know, with a broken leg or whatever. It's amazing all he does. And then he has a baby in a box, which he takes over. But then that's when the turn happens, is when he betrays his deaf child.
Yeah.
His deaf adopted child. That's when the thing.
That's when
happens.
You lost any remotely like understanding or compassion for the character. At that point, you're just like, you are the scum of the earth.
Exactly. And the progression of him as well within, and all these other things that he encounters, like the weird dude who's lying to him about being his brother, and then the stuff with Paul Dano, obviously as two brothers, you know, with two twins, or they're apparently twins or something. Which is really, you have to really watch the movie a few times to get that they're twins.
Because they originally didn't have it set up like that.
Yes.
They had Dano, and they just ended up having him do both parts.
Yeah. But there's such great scenes too. I mean, when he's in the church and he's supposedly being saved.
He's on his knees, screaming.
Yeah, just so great. Just all of that, the power he has, and then of course the end scene with Paul Dano, where the Paul Dano is the destruction of religion and that had been judging technology, and you see that both things are fallible, both things are full of sins and lies, and neither institution is worth saving.
Yeah, nothing is altruistic once men get their hands on it.
Exactly.
We corrupt everything we touch because we're imperfect vessels.
That's right.
That's just the nature of who we are. Some people are less imperfect, I guess, when it comes to altruistic stances.
Sure, Tom Hanks.
But nobody's 100%. Really? Tom Hanks is what you're going with?
He's pretty altruistic.
You don't want to choose Gandhi, who may end up on someone's list, or Mother Teresa.
Gandhi's a nice choice.
St. Francis of Assisi.
Tom Hanks is pretty good, too.
You're putting Tom Hanks on Pantheon saint level.
Nobody has a negative word to say about Tom Hanks. That's tough to do in Hollywood.
Okay. Right. Well, this has been a weird moralistic play that I did not anticipate coming.
All right, what's your number five? Let's jump out.
Moving right past.
Yeah, moving right on.
My number five is, we may be punting.
Okay.
Apocalypse Now.
I didn't put it on my list.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it all happens in a certain amount of time that's within a week or so. And so for me, it wasn't.
It didn't span
epic.
Long enough?
Yeah, it didn't span long enough. But absolutely valid. It is on one of the cuts I made right there. One of the cuts I made. So absolutely valid. Go ahead and talk about it. You know I love the heck out of this film.
Oh, yeah. That's why I'm surprised it wasn't on your list.
Look at that. I love that.
Look at it right there.
Look at that.
Right, that's creepy.
I do that sometimes.
Rising up between the two of us.
In my bath.
Sometimes
I'll do that. Yeah,
you got a deep bath. Good for you.
I'm a nutty guy. Anyway, go ahead.
It's at that moment within the culture, we all knew that we were going to look back on the Vietnam War and understand that this wasn't. We're all going to be scarred from this.
Yeah.
We all have sins from this campaign. Nobody walks out saying, "I got to do the right thing." This was not our World War II.
Yeah.
We were just as much bad guys as they were.
Yeah.
And we went on years later to find out under BS pretenses, there was no, boat that fired on our boat that gave us, Johnson just created that so we'd go in and make our move in. And then that's the setup to a movie like this where it's just all these damaged characters intersect with one another. In such a in such a perfect way that to me, that must have been what the Vietnam War was like.
Yeah.
You've seen all these other movies trying to encapsulate the madness of being in this country, fighting a war that has no real end against an enemy that you're not entirely sure who is and who is not. So it corrupts all these people. You see all those images, like the one where the little kids are running down the street and there's a little girl who's completely naked and the U.S. soldiers that are around her lighting cigarettes, having a chat. One guy kind of looks like he's laughing.
Yeah.
That's the Vietnam War.
Yeah.
And this is the movie that tries to expose that mania.
The lunacy of it. Yeah.
This is what happens to ultimately good people, and you put them into this situation. You ask them to do these things.
Young kids.
Young kids that are the most impressionable.
Yeah.
And this is what's going to happen.
Well, and I think what's great, Coppola has these great movie within movie moments where he is playing the director, telling them, no, just come past me. And then Martin Sheen is looking at him like, what the is going on here? You know, we just look at him like, what is this?
Yeah.
And it's that whole idea that we as a country, we're also maturing and needing to see everything. This is like 20 years before OJ, 25 years before OJ. People were watching the Vietnam War in real time on their televisions. CBS was broadcasting or NBC was broadcasting. So the stuff that Coppola is highlighting in that moment is what was happening in the zeitgeist. So people were seeing it like and making decisions for themselves of what was happening.
Yeah, the phrase that I always remember from that time is once Cronkite said that they had lost the war on air, the American general public knew we had lost the war.
Right.
And it is the first battle that was done in real time.
Yeah.
That people could kind of follow along very actively. They could get video or not video, but film of it and catch up better than they could, you know, because before like World War II, they would play those, see what the boys are doing up on the front.
Exactly.
They play those, you know, 5-minute reels beforehand, but everything's hunky dory. And this is just...
That's Private Johnson.
Exactly. Eating his, you know, hot piece of pie there. Look at him. The boys are really giving it to those Nazis out there. Give it to Jerry. Why don't you? And whereas within Vietnam, you just...
It was middle fingers to the camera.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I love it. Like you see it like in Full Metal Jacket, you have a character that is a reporter.
Right.
You see it from their perspective. Like, I'm just trying to tell the story. You see what the story is, and you're like, you really shouldn't tell the story, but you need to tell the story.
Yeah.
It's important to tell this story.
Yeah. Well, the story of the film is Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness. It's what it's based on.
Yeah.
Orson Welles had originally tried to do this film back in the 40s before Citizen Kane. So this was like Coppola kind of, Welles was one of his heroes, kind of taking that mantle on and putting it into Apocalypse Now. And it's so great to watch this. And Brando is fantastic. I mean, it's just so amazing. So there's certainly, you can certainly make an argument for this being an epic, absolutely, because there's so much that's explored above the humanity of war is explored and what it does to you and what it can do to you, because Brando is the result of it gone haywire on a man of intelligence and power, really going off the edge.
That film even destroyed Martin Sheen.
Yes, right.
Eventually. Behind the scenes.
Yeah, behind the scenes. Yeah, great stuff. Hearts of Darkness, fantastic documentary on the making of the film.
What do you got?
My number five, we've finally gotten... to my number five, which is Ben-Hur, 1959, directed by William Wyler, starring my man Charlton Heston, Stephen Boyd as Masala, Jack Hawkins as Quintus Arius. And I want to give a shout-out to the cinematographer, Robert Sutia, because this film is the definition of the word epic, in my opinion. Even though I had to put it at five, I couldn't put it quite higher because there's some cheesy moments. You got to accept that in a film like this, a sword and sandal epic, or a biblical epic. But it's so powerful. I cry every time at the end of this film when Christ is crucified. Every single time.
How many times have you seen it?
I've seen it like 100 times, at least 100 times. I grew up with this film, watching it over and over again. It was something that I watched with my parents. I watched by myself. Every Easter, I bought it on. I had the 40th anniversary big box set.
Not surprised.
Every Easter, I know.
Knowing about your buying habits when it comes to movies, I'm not surprised you got the glossiest, nicest commemorative edition.
If I'm going to spend the money on a movie, I want to get the best one.
It had a lock of Heston's hair.
What it has
behind.
You know what's interesting? It has Heston's diary on the film, so you can watch read his diary of the shooting of this. Fantastic. But what's great about it is to me it explores the religious side of it, but it uses a man exploring his Jewish faith and the he's not even Catholic. He's not even Christian. It's about him being exposed, being an adamant follower of his Jewish faith and being unable to turn away from it, even when his best friend Masala is begging him to do so as a Roman soldier. And he has the price to pay, but his faith pays off, even though he questions his faith throughout the whole movie. His faith pays off with how certain people come into his life as a blessing.
Sure.
And he's able to achieve his revenge, which is in the chariot race, which is one of the most magnificent things ever.
That part I love. That part I love. The rest of it, I'm just like, I've seen it.
You're going to kill me.
Yeah, I don't know if I need to go back and rewatch it.
But it's so great that when he gets run over, like the whole thing, the arguing with the Arab who owns the horses, that's so great, the Romans, the way he's making fun of the Romans. It's so, you have these little quiet moments and then that are subversive, but then these also really quiet moments of beauty in the film. And what the hell is that?
I don't know. Somebody just walked back there. I want to say it's Christian.
Is that Harloff?
Just coming in here being a jerk in the background. Geez. Unprofessional as all hell. Can you imagine if we did that for Schmoes? No, we would be attacked.
Be attacked.
Actually, I believe he assaulted us right there.
What?
Did he assaulted us and the viewer. And if you guys would like to file a class action suit with us against Harloff.
And it won 11 Oscars. I think 11 Oscars, which is
way to be back on task. The man is professional.
Listen, I've dealt with Harloff my whole life. I know what he's doing. Please, this is kid's play. All right.
But that was the best he could do. Didn't even do a fart machine or something. It sounded like a wounded cow.
Yeah.
You got us. Is that a thing?
Speaking of his college girlfriends. All right, what's your number four?
Bing, bang,
boom. Harloff's college girlfriend. Boom. What's your number four?
My number four we might be punting on for you, which is Seven Samurai.
Yeah, you damn right we're punting.
Okay.
All right. Four.
He went back on task, and then he lost the ability to speak, and that's what we do on this show.
All right.
At number four, trust me, I had more revisions to this list.
I'm sure, dude. Me
than
too.
In one in a long time. It's been a while. Me too.
My number four is 2001, A Space Odyssey.
It was a tough omission.
Wow. It was a tough omission. Okay. 1968, Stanley Kubrick. Nobody of real note. Cara Dulia, Gary Lockwood are the two actors.
Yeah, it's not about the actors.
But it's about the computer.
Yeah.
And
it's about the story.
Yeah, the story, the exploration.
It's about evolution.
The space baby.
Exactly. The man starting at point A and then eventually actually coming up against something that is better than them at almost every capacity.
Yeah.
And we built our own demise, which you love in a movie.
I do love. I love when we build our own demise. I keep looking at the wrong camera. They set me up at the wrong camera.
I just love hearing their giggles in the background.
Yeah.
Are we blaming that? Well, that's the class action.
Those
class
giggle games. No, but it's so fun to watch this movie. And the movie still, it's one of the top two sci-fi films still ever made. That and Blade Runner are one and two for me. So spoiler alert, if we ever do sci-fi movies, you guys know that's my one and two. Mm-hmm. But like,
I don't think we're ever going to do it. So you're safe. We're never going to get to that one somehow.
But 2001 is just the exploration you have. You have the monkeys, you have the monolith, you have, oh, not the monkeys, I'm sorry, the prehistoric man banging the bones or whatever. And
But against, it's a monolith.
And then they go to the, so we're dealing with the future, what's in the future. But some of the shots are some of the most poetic things ever filmed. The slow
just getting
pace
that without
it,
CGI.
That's amazing.
All those gorgeous shots. Right? Like, it's kind of one of those of, you see that from Kubrick and you're like, this guy has so much skill.
Yeah.
It's almost hard to understand.
Yeah.
Because you see everything that came out around him. It's like you're playing a different game.
Well, that's why they accused him of filming the moon landing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
which is an excellent documentary.
Yes, it is. Room 237.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not room 227. That's another documentary.
Hey, Jack. I remember that show. I watched it. Was that on TGI Fridays?
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
Something like that way back in the day. which is excellent. And you see this movie and you're like, I believe you might have been able to fool the American public with faking the moon landing. Do I think that happened? No, I don't. I'm not a conspiracy theorist that buys into that one.
Then again, we have never gone back to the moon.
Yeah, so, I got a buddy that he's a professor in college and he believes that.
Yeah, oh, wow.
This is just his one random thing. I don't think we've ever been to the moon.
Wow.
And he's got reasons and all this list and it's just like, wow, man, I can't believe we agree on 99% of life and this is where we deviate.
It's all right, though.
Everybody's got their crazy.
99-1 is good.
Yeah, but you see this in the cinematography, the choice of shot selections, the amount of work they had to do go into building all these sets to get everything that he wanted in this film. And it is a sweeping epic.
Yeah.
It was tough to leave off. But it's another, like, what's the hero? To me, epic is this epic journey and fight and all that struggle.
Right.
And this is just kind of like man's inevitable demise on some level.
It is, but it's also a rebirth. And that's what the space baby symbolizes at the end, right? A lot of people have a tough time breaking down the end of the movie or have a lot of different interpretations, what I'm trying to say. They have a lot of different interpretations. So you see it going through that motion. And then, like, when the space baby appears, and you get the monolith and you get him being old, you get all this, which, you know, it's so fascinating to talk about black holes. And you go into that black hole, it bends time and space, so you don't know what's happening. You don't know how long you're in there for.
Oh, no, you get
it's
ripped.
right?
To parts. It's your subatomic structure.
Yeah, exactly.
You're redeposited who knows where.
Yeah.
Some spit out on the event horizon. Yeah, exactly. Right. But who knows what's on the other side of a black hole? Because as of right now, nobody.
Nobody's ever come out of it.
I don't know what happens. Yeah. Could be a lot of fun. Or it could be brutally painful.
It's great cinematography from that, too. From
Harloff is everywhere. Now he's
really
doing it over there. This guy.
All right, so what's your number three?
My number three is, I'm guessing it didn't make your list, which is Braveheart.
Yeah, no. Not it. No. Yeah, no. It was either Gladiator or Braveheart, and I had to go with Gladiator. So go ahead. Knock yourself out. Mel Gibson.
I'm so stunned.
Sure. Pitch me the French queen sleeping with William Wallace, and I'll accept it.
I'll pitch it to you as, who gives a heck?
I give a heck.
The movie is brilliant in every capacity. It is gorgeous. Now, is it historically accurate? No, not in the slightest. Yeah, not in the slightest. Was there William Wallace? Yes.
Did he, William Wallace.
Exactly. Did he start from these humble beginnings? Not exactly. His uncle that does take him over, take his stewardship, was a very wealthy man.
Yes, he was.
And he joined, I believe, the aristocracy thereafter. Mm-hmm. So that's not exactly true. let's listen. But at the same time, we need to make a more compelling movie, which they do in spades. When his wife gets killed and he comes back to exact revenge on the governor for... Basically, they didn't want to go through prima nocta where the governor of a local area comes in and sleeps with the wife so that they can sire a child and hopefully basically just genetically weed out these ruffian Scots.
Yeah.
We don't want them around. We only want good English stock.
The trouble with Scotland is
full of Scots. And they don't want to have that. And she gets killed because she doesn't want to be raped by a soldier of the English army. But striking a soldier is basically the equivalent of striking the king, which means it's automatic death penalty. And the hurt in his eyes when he exacts his revenge and he cuts that dude's throat.
He doesn't even look at him.
No, but when he turns and looks, he's empty.
Yes.
He knows that did not fill the void.
Yep.
How could it? That is now just one that is going to be added to this endless well within me of me just now slaughtering as many of you dogs as I possibly can.
Yeah.
And he does it through strength and intelligence and cunning. And also, that's where he needs the French queen.
Yeah.
A little bit of political needs here and there.
Helps. Sure.
Oh, of course.
Sure.
Of course. And he needs Robert the Bruce because he has to rally the aristocrats if he's actually going to pull the number of forces. Mm-hmm. Just like we were talking about earlier with Russell Crowe and Maximus, Marcus Aurelius, is he knew that he could only do so much.
Yep.
And eventually just like, I pledge to you because with you, I believe in you. And through you, I can succeed and achieve the goals that I need to. And at the end, when he screams freedom to this day, you want to talk about you cry, Ben-Hur, the hairs on the back of my neck stand up, my heart rate picks up. I don't know, a few other things perhaps happen. My palms get sweaty, mom's spaghetti. I got no idea, but it is fantastic.
Nice.
It is excellent. It should be on your list.
Great.
I got nothing for you. I'm flabbergasted right now.
Clearly, and that's an amazing mic drop. I don't think I can add anything to that. That's a great pitch
for
the film.
How could you? It's not on your list. What are you going to add? You're just going to poo-poo all over it, and we don't need that.
I don't want to poo-poo all over it.
You're going to poo-poo all over
it. The French queen thing. It's like Samwise Gamgee.
You just poo-pooed on it. You said you wouldn't, and then you went right back on your word.
No, I just said, all right, let's move on.
What do you
got? My number three. Is The Godfather Part 2.
Punting.
Woo! Nice. What's your number two?
My number two, this one's kind of a stretch. This one is kind of a stretch.
This one is. Okay.
This Braveheart one is.
Wasn't, but this is. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, well, all right.
No, go ahead. We're running out of time. Go ahead.
My number two is Star Wars. Walk it off. I'll finish the show by myself, and I will do two in one. You can sell me that it needs to be the overall arc of the first three, but they made the first one without knowing that it was going to be a three-parter.
They're just catering to the fans.
Why? It's an epic.
This is not an epic film.
Yes, it is. It is a hero's journey. It has huge sets. It's got lavish costumes.
Oh, it's got huge sets, yes. This is lavish. This is not lavish.
What are you talking about?
Come on, I made this with a couple of towels. This is not lavish. It's a bed sheet.
They go to different worlds. They blow up a world. They got so many worlds, they're just like, screw it. Let's just blow this one up. Who even cares? Because we designed this huge space station.
Right at the beginning.
It is a spanning story. It's the hero's journey. It's one of the best hero's journeys from my childhood.
Okay.
You can't fight me on this.
I can, but we're running out of time, but I won't.
You really can't.
Because I host the Star Wars show, so I can't really say it's, you know. I just don't see it as an epic film because it is the first in a trilogy.
But
the entire
trilogy
is epic.
You didn't know it at the time. So if you just watch it from the one, because given the overall span of the first film, it is the most epic to me because they tried to make the most singularly standalone film.
Okay.
So other people tried to sell me because I talked about like this list was so hard because anything could kind of go. And other people were pushing for Empire. And I was just like, yeah, but Empire knew that there's a third one coming and had something setting up, whereas this is just like, it's a one and done. Right. So we have this overall, and they built up all these characters and this backstory and this struggle between warring factions and, you know, the underdog versus the big man. And it's got a ton of qualities that every epic has.
Okay.
So,
all right.
It's a space Western epic.
It happens in like a week, though. So I don't know.
How do you, there is no time.
I don't know. I'm just saying.
Really? They refer to watches and be like, hey, Tuesday? Tuesday. We're doing that Tuesday, guys.
I'll kill him Tuesday.
Yeah. I have no idea how long because you never see a sunset. So I don't think exactly exist way.
That's true.
On that planet.
Hey-o.
But they're traveling at light speed past millions of stars.
That's true. In their bucket of bolts.
So I don't know how they tell time.
All right. My number two. My number two is Seven Samurai, which I guess we punted from. What's your number?
Originally, that was my number two, and after reordering, and that became my number four.
You're out of your mind. Number two, Seven Samurai, 1954, Akira Kurosawa, one of the greatest films ever made, period, by one of the greatest directors ever, if not the greatest director ever, Akira Kurosawa. Toshirô Mifune is introduced to the world in this movie. Takashi Shimura is fantastic as the lead samurai.
Yeah, he's my favorite part of it.
He is great. If you've ever seen Ikiru, that's another fantastic film by Kurosawa that has him in modern day Japan at the time becoming a 3-hour film about him.
Yeah.
Like giving all this stuff away. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. It's so good. The characters are so rich. The themes that are explored are really powerful stuff between like, you know, this life they've chosen and protecting these people and defending the defenseless.
It's the first team up.
But then having the, right? Yes, yes.
And now we have that in movies because of this movie.
Yeah.
Like there are the direct knockoffs of True Grit and the rehash of True Grit that's, you know, that's coming out.
Yes.
Eventually in the fall.
Right.
But they've taken this formula and they've done it for other
Magnificent
movies.
Magnificent Seven, not True Grit. You said True Grit.
I'm sorry, not True Grit. Yeah, Magnificent Seven.
Yeah.
And they've done it for other movies that don't even have to do anything with basically, you know, remakes of this original.
Yeah.
And it's such a simple idea of like, I can't believe this didn't exist in film before this came out.
And that's what's amazing about it. Like, I read that book, The Emperor and the Wolf, which is 970 pages, is insane. But like, he talks about how
you want
they.
A cookie?
No,
is that
I'm
the
just
longest
saying.
Book you've ever read?
No, yeah, probably.
Okay. But all right. Well, then, all right. Congratulations.
It's just what explores his writing style. Like, he wrote a lot of these movies, so he had all these thoughts in his head about this and putting this together. He had co-writers, obviously, but putting this together, you're right. First kind of team up. And what they do with it is exploring this whole idea of agricultural, what does that mean? And then having these farmers turn on the samurai by hiding stuff from them, hiding their women from them, which is a judgment on the samurai, even though they needed the samurai to defend them. So there's all kinds of stuff going on here that is no one's like really good or bad because the bandits needed to survive, to eat, to live.
But it's because of the caste system within Japan.
Yes, exactly.
So yes, the farmers need their help, but according to them and the social norms that they've all been brought up on, they all know that these mercenaries are less than them.
Yes.
They're ronin. They're not even samurai.
Right.
So they're just hired guns. So they're lower on the society's totem pole as opposed to if they were samurai, then that's the highest of the high of their profession.
Yeah.
And these guys are just, you know, basically vagabonds that are looking. They do this job for food.
Yeah.
Not even for money and food. It's like, no, we'll give you 2 to 3 squares a day and a cot. That's it.
But it's also the excitement of what they're doing. Like there's a code within them, and the reason they take the job is to protect these people because they are good people at heart, the ones he finds.
Well, you find out that code early on when they're trying to amass the team.
The tests that they do are fantastic.
Well, and they find the one guy because some other drunken idiot or something confronts him, and he does what happens in, you know, a lot of movies like this. One guy's like, you don't want to do this.
Yeah.
You don't. And he just stands there so like still and calm and centered. And the other guy's like, no, I will do this. And you're like, this dude is dead.
The swordsman.
Yeah, exactly.
The quiet swordsman. Yeah.
Exactly. Quietly just cuts him up and then resheathes and goes about his day.
Yeah. And I would argue that the deaths in the film, when they occur later on, are powerful, very powerful films. Very powerful deaths that you, because you have, even though you're not like, you know, like, this is not your culture, you gravitate to these characters so well because they're so well acted, so well done, and the archetypes are things that you can understand and connect to in such a way so that when the ending happens and they have that conversation about, well, this is our life, you know, we've chosen this as a life.
This is their win, not ours.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Which is great because they keep going and we have to go find our next situation.
It's what I believe is called a Pyrrhic victory. It's like where, yes, we may have won, but we suffered such heavy casualties that we're walking out of this, you know, just as damaged as they are. Yeah. We just happen to win.
More relieved than anything else.
Yeah.
All right. What's your number one?
My number one is a punt from yours, which is Godfather 2.
Okay. Let's talk about it.
You want to talk about it? Just an epic movie. Now, this isn't a hero's journey, but this seems more rooted in real life in that there are no real true heroes in life. Yeah. Everybody exists in some varying form of gray.
Now, maybe Frankie Pentangeli is a hero, maybe. So, I said, sure. Michael Corleone did this. I said, yeah, sure. But I love Pentangeli, yeah.
Corleone. We're going to add that too, the impression corner. So that's at least three we've discussed on air.
Oh,
we're going to keep adding.
Yeah, they said Michael Corleone did this. Yeah, go ahead. Anyway.
Well, Corleone is not a good character.
He's not a good person. He's not a good character.
Yeah, I apologize. Yeah, correct. Yeah, yeah. He's not. You can find fault at almost every turn.
Absolutely.
Even when technically the best thing that he does is kill another man in the first movie.
Yeah.
That's still a terrible thing to do. And for that to be your best redeeming quality as we, an audience, can see fit.
Yeah.
And it only gets worse from there in the second film.
Mm-hmm. Because he talks himself into it. He talks himself into it. He's, no, you know, he has that line with Kay. He's like, Kay, do you think senators, who's being naive, Kay? Who's being naive? Senators don't have people killed. Who's being naive, Kay?
Yeah.
And, but it's his way of explaining his behavior, rationalizing his behavior, even though he knows, as a military guy, he knows what he's doing is wrong. He's rationalized it for himself because family is more important than anything else.
That's just because that's what he chooses to believe.
Right.
Whereas the politician is choosing to believe, if I can help myself and America, then that's the right thing to do. And just as like whatever other side that would take these means, the means to get these ends, which is killing people to unobstruct them from whatever path or goal that you have.
Yeah.
But he's right. Once you get to that height of power, people die.
Yeah.
People die a lot.
Exactly.
Sometimes it's just on a simple thing as a choice of, we need to go there. Well, we're going to have to displace a bunch of people.
Well, and I think it's great, too, because you have the juxtaposition of the Robert De Niro story of Vito Corleone, which is Pacino's father in the movie, as De Niro's playing the Brando part as a young, and you're seeing how he came up and how he did it almost bloodless, and the people that die deserve to die.
Yeah.
Juxtaposed with what Michael is doing, which is a more of a, it's even more vicious and almost sociopathic in how he's doing it, because
without a doubt.
Yeah, because even when he gets to that moment where he slaps Kay because of the abortion, and then he does what he does to his brother, because it's the destruction of family. What he thought he was doing in embracing the family, fighting for the family, defending the family, when he's so noble in the first one and taking over for his father and avenging the five people who are supposed to die, the head of the five families, for his father. What it does is corrode him from within, because he thinks family is so important, but then family betrays him and family lets him down, and he has nothing left but his bitterness. And that's why the last shot of him as fall, the leaves of fall, is him, is the decay of him, you know, the decay of the leaves.
Oh, yeah. Well, here comes the winter of his life.
Yeah, the winter of his life, which is full of nothing. It's going to be full of nothing.
I think
And the third one never happens, so that's what happens.
The great juxtaposition, too, is what you brought up earlier. The younger De Niro character you side with because you understand the choices that he's making.
Yeah.
And when it comes time to actually make that final choice of whether or not a person has to die, the difference between the two characters is, you know, young version of Brando does it himself. Corleone farms it out.
Yes, exactly.
And the fact that he has to distance himself, he knows that that is a terrible decision, and it's a stain on his soul and his conscience.
Yeah.
But he can be like, you know, that guy technically did it. It was at my order and whatnot, but I didn't kill
he's
him.
He's a tyrant.
He is.
Even Duvall has to worry about his life, who's been his brother his whole freaking life.
But he's not family.
He's not family. That's the thing.
At the end of the day, there is that distinction. You're not blood, even though you were raised as blood, and I have treated you as such my entire life. If it comes down between choice of you and helping the family in any way, shape, or form, adios, my friend.
Yeah, the cold nature of when he goes, you're out, Tom. It's just like so brutal. Anyway, all right, so my number one, which I am surprised is not on your list. Lawrence of Arabia, 1962, Peter O'Toole, directed by David Lean. How is this not even on your list?
Now, do you want this to count? It's like 1 through 5 on your list?
It's probably 1 through 5, yes. And then we can argue 6 through 10.
I knew as soon as Epics came up, and I was like, well, Lawrence of Arabia is making...
Yeah, it did. Lawrence of Arabia,
by the way. It's Lawrence of Arabia. That's wormed its way into my head as being the replacement now. Good times.
What a phenomenal film. It won 7 Oscars, Best Picture, Best Director. Peter O'Toole, criminal that he didn't win Best Actor.
Yeah.
He should have won Best Actor. Still, his greatest piece as an actor, bar none. the scope of the film is so amazing. The fact that they go through this whole war, you see his progression as a man from a young, soldier guy to what he is now, and what he becomes at the end of the film is the bitterness of what he'd had to endure and mm-hmm. put himself through for his own means of, like, yeah, going after what he wanted to go after.
Sure.
It's just so powerful to watch his progression. And there's a nobility to it. Then he gets cocky. He gets arrogant, which is where the Turkish guy rapes him. And then he has to come back and figure out how to come back to normal from that bitterness. Meanwhile, he's balancing Anthony Quinn's nuttiness on one side, Omar Sharif's judgment on the other, and then Alec Guinness playing all the chess pieces at the same time. Mm-hmm. It's just fantastic, such a film. And the progression you see, not only in the beauty of the desert, like, they make the desert so beautiful in this film, something to explore and enjoy. And then you see the progression of him as a man who ends up, you know, dying early, but leaving this amazing story of his life, you know? And so to me, it's very epic in scale. The shots, the costumes, the sets, everything that happens. And then the deaths that happen randomly through the film that undercut his heart and really send him down this path, you know? So that's why I love the film so much, man.
The best part is I've heard you describe to me, I think, four times, five
times?
Yeah. It's come up on various lists why you love the film, and you managed to find a different way to express that love. This time, I'm impressed. You love the film. You ever done the Fassbender in Prometheus, where you've dyed your hair with the hardcore and just sat and watched it?
That's called cosplay. I did not do that.
I think it's a little bit more mania if the person was alive.
That's true.
So,
all right. Well, that's our list separately. Let's take a look at them now. Our top 10 epics. Matt, let's take a look at Matt Nost's list first.
Let's see that list.
Oh, look at that.
I aged so well.
You shall not know.
For being that gray, not too wrinkly.
Look at that.
All right. At 10, Spartacus. At 9, Last of the Mohicans. At 8, Gladiator. At 7, Master and Commander, The Far Side of the World. At 6, The Lord of the Rings, Return of the King. At 5, Apocalypse Now. At 4, Seven Samurai. At 3, Braveheart.
Yes, okay.
At 2, Star Wars. And finally, at number 1, The Godfather Part 2.
All right. Great list.
Thank you.
Other than some of the lists.
Excellent list.
Let's take a look at mine. Let's take a look at what I've got here. Oh!
That's a weird picture to choose.
That is weird.
For that pose.
Somebody gave me the George Michael haircut from 2005.
It's like you're fabulous with that sword.
Yeah.
Here's my sword!
All right, my number 10 is Bridge on the River Kwai. 9, The Last Emperor. 8, Gladiator. 7, Spartacus. 6, There Will Be Blood. 5, Ben-Hur. 4, 2001, A Space Odyssey. 3, Godfather Part 2. 2, Seven Samurai. And number 1, as always, Lawrence of Arabia. All right, let's take a look at Cody there. Stan, hey, Cody, thanks. Look at it. He's going to write it down. Our top 10 epics. Yes, we're doing this for the first time.
I love his Vanna White movements. That was beautiful.
He's great.
Right there?
Yes.
At number 1. Well, I think we already know what number 1 is.
Well, yeah, we do. Lawrence of Arabia.
I don't think so. Not on my list.
What are you talking about?
We both have Godfather in our top 3. So I think, put it on the board, Cody. At number 1 is The Godfather Part 2. Godfather Part 2.
Then number 2 is Lawrence of Arabia. I don't want to hear any discussion about
that. Okay, well, I was about to say, we both have Seven Samurai higher.
I don't care. Lawrence of Arabia will be number 2.
All right, so then Seven Samurai next.
Yes, absolutely. Every once in a while, I put my hammer down. I got to put my hammer down on that one. It has to be in the top 2.
Trademarked 2016 Top 10 Show, the Roka Hammer. It'll be in stores just in time for Christmas.
Hey-o!
At number 3, yeah. I would appreciate... pardon me, number 4. You're right.
3 was Seven Samurai.
3 Seven Correct. Samurai, yeah.
3 Let's was Seven Samurai. At number 4, yeah. Star Wars, I think should go right there. Listen, I've given you Lawrence that
You've
I don't
given
have
me nothing.
At number 2, and
it
I bumped
merited.
Up Seven Samurai. So you get your top 2 in the top 3, and I get my top 2 in the top 4.
Who's your top 2? Star Wars, your number 2?
My number 2.
All right, fine.
Put it on the board.
Put it on. It
should not be
at
there.
At number 4.
All right, whenever.
It should totally be there. Now we're. What do we got next?
I got 2001, A Space Odyssey. I feel like,
which I don't have on my list.
Yeah, I feel like that should go.
We got a bunch of whole. Okay,
you don't have Ben-Hur on your list.
I don't have Ben-Hur. And
Spartacus
I'll fight
is the next thing we have.
That seems really high.
Yeah,
to
that's
me
what
from
I'm
Spartacus.
Saying. That's what I'm saying.
All right,
so 2001.
Fine.
2001, Space Odyssey.
2001.
Boom! Nailed it.
Then I'm taking Braveheart next.
Oh!
Right after 2001.
Blah.
The Mel Gibson classic. That is gorgeous right
Make sure
there.
You write down, slept
His
with the French queen.
His is really good.
Slept with the French queen.
You would have been a good italics. College professor up on the whiteboard. I don't know what you would teach, but you would have been
Slept with the French queen. All right, number 7.
What do you got next?
I have Ben-Hur next.
Don't have it at all.
That's going to make the list at some point.
I got Apocalypse Now next. Mm. You don't like it because of the week. Why don't we just go and do Spartacus next?
Spartacus next.
Spartacus,
Spartacus next.
Next. Easy peasy at number 7.
And we have Gladiator at 8, so we might as well put that at 8.
I'm totally fine with
yes.
that. Gladiator at 8.
Okay.
One sandal epic after another.
Now, I...
Pick one that you want.
Ben-Hur.
Wow, really? That's what you want more than anything else on your list?
Yes.
Are you going to cry at the end of this list?
I'm not going to. I might cry if we play the end of Ben-Hur. what do you have?
Next, I got Apocalypse Now.
All right, I'm happy with that at 10.
I'm happy with that at 9.
But I'm happier with it at 10.
You've gotten every one of these battles.
What do you mean I've gotten it? You put Star Wars at 4. What have I gotten?
You got 2001. You got Lawrence of Arabia.
I did it again. You're right. You're doing it on purpose now.
It's because someone said that stupid joke to me, like, this is how bad this film's going to be. Yeah. And I heard it, and it's wormed its way into my head.
Come on, it's
fine. He gets
Ben-Hur at number 9.
He gets it. Point goes to Roka.
Nailed it.
Ben-Hur.
I mean, it's up here.
So what? Because the image is behind you?
We're doing it inspired by the remake.
At 10 is Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now.
That's fine. Fine.
That's beyond fine. Why is it every one of my picks, you give me this disgruntled, grumpy old man?
I didn't give you that on Godfather Part 2.
Yeah, exactly. But you did for everything else I wanted on there.
It's not true.
It is 100% true.
Right, maybe I did.
Yeah, Star Wars, right. Braveheart, Apocalypse Now.
Let's do it. Why don't you start us off since it's your...
At number 10, we've got Apocalypse Now.
I can't read that. At number 9 is Ben-Hur.
At 8 is Gladiator.
At 7, Spartacus. I'm Spartacus.
At 6, Braveheart.
Number 5, 2001, A Space Odyssey.
At number 4, Star Wars.
Number 3, Seven Samurai.
At 2, Lawrence of Arabia.
Hey, got it right.
Thank you.
The number 1 is Godfather.
Número dos.
Part 2, yes. Great list. A lot of epics there. Stuff we talked about. I'm sure there's epics we left
Tons
off.
Of stuff.
Yeah,
Tons
Dr.
Of stuff.
Zhivago, Schindler's List, Patton. Gandhi.
Life of Pi.
What?
Life of Pi? Although it doesn't span long enough time.
Yeah, probably.
Saving Private Ryan, you could give me that.
Yeesh.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I mean, look, this can keep going. The Right Stuff.
The Right Stuff, great film. True, could be
that,
an epic.
That just
Once Upon
got
a Time
off.
In America, also good stuff. All right, so that's our list. Thanks so much, everybody, for watching this week. We really appreciate you guys commenting on Twitter, on Instagram, on YouTube, on Facebook, all that stuff. It just keeps us going. As you can see, we listened. People were arguing that the compiling of the lists was missing. So we'll see if this satisfies those people, and we've kind of found our compromise.
Yeah, we may end up tweaking this idea just a little bit better. Like, you know, as much as we love Cody and his penmanship is, you know, it's fantastic. Look at that. One more shout
really
of that if we
stuff.
Could right
yeah,
there.
Thank you,
good
Cody.
Stuff. We may end up coming up with something like a better tweak on that. We
Who
have
knows?
No idea, but
maybe a prettier girl. We might get
maybe,
that. I would be happy
perhaps.
With that.
He is quite dashing.
He is dashing, though. Yes. All right. Thanks, everybody, for what Matt, you want to tell them where to find us or what?
You can email us at top10podcast, all spelled out, top10podcast@gmail.com, or on Facebook, facebook.com/the top10podcast with the number 10. And actually, if you want to, I am. You can follow me on Twitter. I will actually tweet. I lost a bet with my wife. So
there
please follow me on Twitter. Let's attack John together. I don't know why I just said that.
Why not?
I don't know why I said that.
That's all right. Stan is par for the course. At Matt Nost, you can find him there.
At Matt Nost.
You can find me at The Roka Says on Twitter and Instagram. See all the shows I'm hosting, co-hosting, and guest on. Those kinds of things. We're running out of time, so there's not much more to say. Thanks, everybody. Follow us at Top 10 Show. Subscribe to the channel. Watch all the great work that's here, all the great shows that are here. Please, there's so much content that you will enjoy and love. And big shout out to Adam and Cody for
Thank
helping
you, gentlemen.
Us do the show.
Another professional job. That's I right. say we now go whoop Harloff's butt. You know what I mean?
All right, there we go. All right, thanks, everybody, for watching this week.
Bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.